Okay, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, we are proud to pronounce our next guest over here. We have a great discussion that I'm even very interested in, and we're gonna speak about and listen about the gaming, all right? Who is distributing the gaming in industry? Who is disrupting it right now? All right, ladies and gentlemen, we have amazing guests over here. We're gonna speak up with them and gonna listen to them and get ready to maybe add some questions. I will do this definitely. So ladies and gentlemen, first person here on the stage I would like to invite is Mr. Zbignev Monkevič. Please welcome Zbignev. He's a senior Q&A manager at Unity Technologies. All right, the next one is Arnoldas, Žvinys. Arnoldas is a chief operating officer at Estoty, Vilnius. All right, Vilnius. Pasakiau, kiek sustanėlės. All right, vakare. And next one is Vaidas Mikelskas. Mr. Vaidas, please welcome on the stage. Vaidas is a just a gamer, user experience designer at Sneaky Box Studios. And we have a moderator over here. It's a Tautvydas, Pipiras, project manager at Lithuanian Innovation Center. All right, guys. We're gonna speak about games right now. Ladies, you will be also interested because I think they're gonna speak about this very interesting way. All right, guys, are you ready?
Yes.
All right, are we ready? Woo! Come on, let's go.
Yeah, so hello everyone. Nice to see you all here. I'm Tautvydas from Lithuanian Innovation Center. And before moving into the discussion about the gaming, I want to make a small survey out here as we are live here in Vilnius. So maybe you can raise your hands if you consider yourself as a gamer or ex-gamer to see how many of you are. Yeah, we have few of you here, and I think those who didn't raise their hands just forget how passionately they were trying to break those records on Snake on their old Nokia, or played the Candy Crush or other puzzles. But the gaming industry has gone further since then, and it is estimated right now that at least 40% of the whole global population will be playing games in the nearest future. So it means that 3.5 billion people around the world until 2025 will be gamers. That's the market. And for comparison, the Netflix currently has around 200 million subscribers. So the gaming is totally taking the attention economy, and we will try to dive deeper into this market with our speakers out here, and we will try to sort out why gaming industry keeps us fascinating. Also, the gaming industry is the driving force of the technologies for many years. So we will see what kind of shifts we are expecting in the upcoming years, and how it will change the gaming industry, and also how it will impact other sectors as well. So without further ado, I want to present our speakers, our guests out here. So next to me, we are having a quality assurance specialist at Unit, one of the leading global companies in the world, in the gaming industry. Also, Arnoldas Žvinys, the chief operating officer at game development studio here in Vilnius. They have released plenty of very successful games that reached 100 million of downloads currently. So that's a really big hit out in the global market. And also we are having Vaidas Mikelskas, the representative of Sneaky Box. He's a user experience manager out there. And the Sneaky Box is an award-winning studio making their own games, working with other big studios, and also providing services for other sectors. And to start with, I want to ask you, Zbignev, what was the impact of the pandemic situation for the global industry from the supply chain, supply side, and from the demand side?
Okay. Just to start it off, I wanted to thank our amazing introducer who made me feel like a rock star for 20 seconds. And he's not even paying attention watching his phone. But so yeah, pandemic. Pandemic introduced, I think, a lot of shifts and change to majority of industries. And unfortunately, for most, it was negative change. In game industry, we were happy enough that it actually made people stay at home and either discover or simply spend more time playing games, and thus it meant more people playing mobile games, more people buying consoles and playing PC games. It also meant more people tried to create games themselves, so it was very positive for us. And it's nice to see that a lot of these people are actually developing a new hobby and realizing that they would like to continue doing so even after the pandemic stops and they can go out.
Yeah, and you said also that people could stay at home and play game, but actually what I checked, that the biggest increase in the revenue was achieved by the Pokemon Go, which encouraged people to go outside and just search for those great stuff outside. And it's an interesting fact as well. I think it fosters the movement among the people. And Arnoldas, I want to ask you, how you managed to cope with the changes during the pandemic? Because you know, maybe you saw some kind of shift in the consumers' behavior. Maybe it was increased of the sessions or the length of the sessions, and how you managed to react very quickly when these kind of changes were happening.
Well, we didn't notice so big changes in our industry, in our market, which we are following. By the way, we develop games for hyper-casual market. So they are easy gameplay games which you could play, I don't know, in every situation in your life, when you wait for bus, when you, I don't know, watching TV at the same time, for example. So these kind of games, according to some data, were booming. It was like numbers were going double. And of course, we would probably not see the same kind of growth this year. But from our perspective, as a game developer, we live according to a bit different kind of cycles. Each our game has its life cycle. It's growing. It has a peak, and then it's going down. So we live according to these cycles. We did not have so big impact, like a global impact. But on the other hand, of course, when the market is expanding, mobile games are expanding and hyper-casual games are booming, that means that there's more space for all the competitors. So, that's a positive note.
And I know that Sneakybox was also searching for new niches during the pandemic, but not especially in the game development, but also, they were supporting other sectors with various solutions in VR, AR. Could you elaborate on that, how the whole market changed in other sectors and how gaming companies helped to overcome that problem that we were not able to see each other personally?
Yeah, so basically the start of the pandemic was kind of crazy and really scary for everybody, especially places that do not have a big online presence, stuff like museums, especially Lithuanian museums, or like online or like shops that don't have online presence, like brick and mortar shops that sell, I don't know, furniture and stuff like that. You know, it's really difficult for those kind of companies or organizations to be on the internet because most of what they do is really physical. So we did expand into trying to help these kind of organizations to have an online presence with, 360, expositions, which you could go in and explore on the browser with like solutions with AR. For instance, if they're selling some sort of a product, you can just take the product and place it in your real environment. You know, is it a fridge or a sink or something like that? So we try to help out both businesses and museums with such solutions.
Okay, that's really nice, and I know that Unity is also working not only on the game development field, but it's a really big technology company. And could you just tell people what kind of sectors you're approaching and what kind of technologies you're using in the game development, but also on other sectors?
Previously, in general, our mission was to democratize game development. And I think we managed to kind of do it because like majority of games are now made with Unity. So our vision expanded to, in general, have more creators in the world, an ability for people to make stuff. Nowadays, it's architecture, automotive, simply allowing people to make any mobile app and so on with it. And then more exciting, at least for me, like VR, augmented reality, and in general, the whole idea of metaverse that someday we'll manage to have this virtual world like you would see in the movies and sci-fi stuff.
And yeah, I want to dive deeper maybe into that metaverse world. And as probably in the upcoming 10 years, we will build our physical world as we are doing right now, but also we all have that not physical, but meta world, where we also will buy stuff out there, we will plan everything out there. How this thing is developing right now, what kind of market maybe do you know out there, and what developers can do with this market?
I think in general, a lot of industries are trying to make it virtual. As Vaidas mentioned, like, oh, how about you being able to select your furniture and instantly try it in your home? I mean, I know myself, I personally would create my apartment in Sims and then try to move stuff around to see how it looks. And in general, there's a lot of VR and AR apps which are very popular, where simply people come and to hang out with their friends. I know some of our team meetings in the other teams would happen like in Red Dead Redemption, where we're doing a story mission together and discussing their sprint. I'm like, what? What? We are social creatures and we want that. And being locked at home showed us that we can definitely innovate on how it might happen. And there's a lot of innovations happening both in VR and headsets and in general, like recently, Google presenting this TV where you'd have meetings with somebody actually like 3D and feeling like they are there with you and so on.
Yeah, and it's a really crazy market because I read that some of the people are just doing business on creating a virtual plant or something that could be bought and installed in the games, and they're selling them better than the real plants. So the global life is really going into that virtual meta world. But talking about the game development business, I want to go back to that. And Vaidai, Sneaky Box was during the pandemic, you were considering to creating a new team, which is only for the game development, and you were thinking of the new projects, new game ideas, what you could create. But what impacted that? What, did you see some kind of new niche out there, new market in the game industry, and how your decisions were impacted by the partnership that you had earlier? Because I know that Sneaky Box were working together with such a big names as Atari. Also, you have in partnership Xbox and other companies. So how those big names and big partnerships help you to create new ideas and to, you know, find your way in this global market?
So basically, as I've mentioned, the pandemic hit quite kind of weird. And at the start, it was really chaotic, but later on, like, it kind of settled down, and everybody noticed that what are people doing at home? They were either watching TV or playing video games, and most of them were playing video games. So in this kind of world where everybody's playing games, there's not really enough games to play. So a lot of publishers and big companies really went out and tried to gather teams of smaller developers, or even acquiring them, or just publishing these companies' games. And it's interesting how basically the most interesting thing they want is not that it's a cool game idea, but they want your agency. So they want you to be involved in the project, and they want you to feel like it's yours, you know. So you own this project, this product, and they want to help you, you know, show it, sell it to the people. And basically, if we're all used to this idea that okay, so this company wants some sort of a game, we're gonna make three options for them to choose from, three ideas, like high-level pitches. And then you come into the meeting, and they don't really want to see all three of them. They just say, which one do you believe in? And basically, it kind of created this market of, like, they put money on the table, and they want you to believe in your own product and really own it.
Yeah, and you mentioned that it is really important in this industry to communicate about the ideas. The idea is not the most important thing. Also, it's very important to build an ecosystem among your game, and also to build the fans of your game. You are coming from the communication background. Could you elaborate whether it's very hard to find those fans, because we're seeing that, you know, we have a market of 3.5 billion people, and how to find those really trusting fans for your game, and is it very hard to do that, and how to, you know, target those groups?
So there's always going to be people that are, like, really into some specific thing, and if you can hit that, you don't really need a really big community. I mean, some people do. Some games do have incredibly huge communities, but you don't really need to have a really big community. You need to have a strong community. And if you're making a game for some sort of a niche player, there's always going to be people who are really into that stuff, and they're going to find you. They will. I don't know how, but if you're on the internet, they will find you.
Yeah, and Arnoldas, you can really brag about the big community that you have. As I already mentioned, 200 million downloads of your top game. Yeah, am I right?
Yeah, that's correct. Johnny Trigger has over 200 million downloads.
And you mentioned that you are creating those hyper-casual games, which means that they have a pretty short life cycle. So they are the hits, and later it's harder to build the bigger community, and it means that your studio has to constantly develop new creative ideas to do new projects and etc. So how do you create that culture in your organization? How you manage those people to always be creative, always take that extra step for the project?
Yeah, it's actually a very good question. Well, first of all, actually our business model allows us to create games that we like, that we don't have to do, like, compromise. We don't have to do games that we don't like to play, or we would not play. So because we don't have any third party that orders games, we do the game that that we want and what our teams think of and develop. So we eliminate this demotivating factor that you are forced to do something for some deadline, for some for somebody else. So that's the biggest factor, I would say. Secondly, in our organization, we work a lot on personal development. We have those called personal development plans, where me, myself including, we meet our CEO once a month, and we track our performance, what kind of value we bring to the company and in our lives as well. The balance, work and life balance is very important for us there. So when you have a a talent who is in good shape, who has who can do sports, healthy food, and so on. It helps a lot not to kill this creativity. And talking about this kind of aspects, we have we invest a lot time and other resources in a comfortable office and in sports space in the office. Not to mention that we work shorter than most of the companies. We start from 9:30 and work until 6, so it's 7.5 hours a day. So, and we continuously looking for those kind of things that would help us to balance. We don't want to squeeze out each other, you know, in the organization. And that basically helps a lot to have this creativity resource that is so essential, especially in hyper-casual market where we work constantly on several projects.
And could you share, maybe there's some kind of secret recipe, you know, how to build those very big hits, or it's every time is a new story and it's a completely different project?
Well, Estoty Vilnius has been established in the year 2014. So during this period, we think that we have found a sustainable business model that could sustain our activity for many years ahead. But of course, each project is a new story with its own fails and with its own success. But we believe that we have some certain know-how and business knowledge that helps us to stay here. And moreover, we still the competition of the games, they are being produced more and more each year in hyper casual. But the market is growing. The hyper casual market is growing. The mobile gaming market in general is growing. So we can still see a lot of potential even for ourselves to grow in this category. Though our teams, they are growing, their skills are growing, and some of them, they start to want to develop something a little bit more complex. So we are doing some experiments, not only in hyper-casual, but a little bit towards so-called hybrid or mid-core games. But those are not released yet, and these are just coming in the future. But what I want to say that it's only coming from the teams, because they want to do that, and we basically allow them to do that and to develop this kind of a little bit different kind of games.
And as I understood, that even the small teams could just create those hits, and that could become such a global success. And I want to ask you, Zbignev, because Unity is working on that they are empowering all the developers to create games and to use various technologies to optimize those games, to find their, I don't know, niche and something. So could you elaborate what kind of technologies you are providing, and what are the most promising technologies you are excited about that could help maybe in the future to make that process even easier?
Yeah, so personally, I always loved games and wanted to create them. So, but back in the days, it was quite complicated, especially if you like trying without no library, just C++, do everything. You quickly realize that you need to create a lot of stuff yourself to make it work. Like, oh, physics, it has to work. Oh, if I want to animate even sprites, how do I do that? And so on. And instead, nowadays, pretty much everything has at least the basic solution, which you can simply use, and instead focus on those creative, cool things Arnoldas described, that you're trying out and prototyping quickly new ideas instead of trying to bother to create a system to enable you to do that. So I think this is very great for any like small team which doesn't have time or resources to put most of their time into creating their own tools. Obviously, bigger companies start implementing then their more specialized solutions specifically for their game to optimize on that. But in general, we try to enable people to do most of the stuff nowadays in the Unity editor itself. So if you're making a 2D game, to be able to make sprites in there, animate them, make your map in there. If you're making a 3D game, maybe actually model stuff inside Unity instead of having to use another software and then put it in. So pretty much that everything is in one place and hopefully as easy as possible. And the other aspect of it is actually making money from it, because it doesn't matter how good the game is if it doesn't sell. Well, after a few, you won't be able to sustain yourself. So it's about making people able to acquire users, about monetizing them, and hopefully having a happy business and having more companies which are successful thanks to that.
Yeah, brilliant answer. And in the gaming industry, not only the developers could make money, but also game industry connects other sectors, and in the mentioned metaverse. So as we are having here more startups, more entrepreneurs, maybe some of you can elaborate how others can enter into game sector and maybe produce their merchandise for the new game, or sell their ideas out there, sell their brands and something, how they could cooperate, and what's the market out there? I don't know.
I think one of the aspects which is successful everywhere is gamifying it and making it social. I know if you are selling even clothes, make it social, make it being able to show how you would look into it or make a photo of it to your friends, for example. And in other cases, if it's something where you want users to constantly come back and use, I don't know, like meditation app, again, maybe have a high score with your friends and so on, because gamification in general, both in education and any entertainment, makes us compete, makes us want a challenge, because it's not about the app, it's about me and my friends having this experience of us being rivals and so on.
Any other comments on that?
So I want to have a little bit of a warning for companies who would like to go into like, oh, we should make a game because everybody's making a game. Don't make a game just because everybody's making a game, and don't make a game just to make a game. The game should probably be a part of a bigger thing in your company, should be part of your communication plan. And if these things don't work together, basically you're wasting your money. Because it's getting cheaper, but it's still expensive to make games. And make sure you have a plan what to do with the game, and then talk to game developers about it.
Okay. Arnoldas, do you have something on that?
I could just add that I agree with Zbignev that probably companies, any kind of startups and companies, could use the principles of game, for gamification of their products. And one good example, I don't know, I really love one app application, Duolingo. It's for language learning. And nowadays, I guess it's more like a game, not a learning application anymore. So I think this way has a lot of potential. I'm not sure about merchandising. Of course, if you have a strong characters, that can be something on the side to cooperate. But the gamification principle itself is very strong, and I think it has a lot of potential.
And I mentioned in the beginning that gaming is an accelerator of new technologies, and also technologies allows to build a new business models like cross-platform, you know, playing, also instant gaming, cloud computing, etc. Could you just share your ideas, what in your opinion is the most promising ones and on which you would bet?
All of them.
Some secrets.
All of the platforms are important. All of the platforms are different. I think in this day and age, it's really important to understand that basically, no matter what platform you're playing on, you're still gonna get a good product, and you're gonna enjoy the game. It's more about the game being good, not the limitations of the platform. I mean, you can play Skyrim on your Alexa, because it's a funny idea, it's an interesting idea, but if the game is good on itself, you can play on everything. And with technologies like instant play and streaming games, you can play on your phone. And you need to think about this from a perspective of a younger person who's, you know, a teenager. They did not start with PCs. They did not start playing games on PCs. They started with mobile phones, and this is their dominant console. So you cannot just lock yourself out of, you know, all of the other consoles and say, "Oh, game mobile is not serious." No, it's super serious, and people are doing super serious stuff on it. And just make sure you have a good idea and make it on all of the consoles possible.
I would personally want VR to succeed the most, mainly due to two reasons. When I first tried it, it made me feel again like a kid who was like first time playing on Sega and like turning with a car. So VR made me feel like that again, like you're forgetting that you're not in real world. And anytime my friends come over, I make them play and, for example, go over the plank, over the skyscraper, and you see this like 190 dude, and like, "Can I not do it, please?" and stuff. And the other very egoistic reason, I hope when I'm gonna be 80, we'll have amazing VR technology, maybe something like in Black Mirror, and I'll just pop it up, and instead of suffering and being like ill old guy, I'll just enjoy myself in the World of Warcraft 27 or something.
So Arnoldas, did you start to prepare this kind of world for us within your studio, or we have to wait like a couple of years for that?
I think we could wait a couple of years.
We have a promise from you that you will build that?
Kind of.
Okay, so as our time is running out, for our listeners, could you give just one recommendation of your favorite game, or recommendations for those who didn't raise their hands at the beginning, just to recommend one good game to start, to be gamer?
I could recommend you could download very easily right now from Android or App Store. Johnny Trigger, that was our game, of course, but it was a game of the year in Lithuania last year. So try from that one, maybe you will like it.
Why this?
Oh, there's so many choices. I don't want to recommend anything super big or serious, but I don't know, it should be a phone game. I don't have any, like, any game, play any game. They're all great in their own ways. It doesn't matter what you start, is it Tetris or like, you know, Snapchat games. They're all pretty great. Just play some games, it's really fun.
Zbignev.
Likely Pokemon Go or the Harry Potter version or anything, because it makes you walk, it makes you actually visit places in our city where you wouldn't usually go. And hopefully if you like either of those universes, enjoying that universe.
And Rolando, I know that you are a real game enthusiast, so
yes,
maybe
I
you
am.
Have your recommendations for the audience.
Of course, guys. On the mobile, you should play PUBG. PUBG Mobile, definitely. Who is watching right now? If you have PlayStation 4 or 5, try Call of Duty. Play Hitman. Play Formula 1. Play games. Play, because I remember the very good commercial of the Xbox. They say, play more, because life is very short. So I think this is the most important thing. As you said, you can play any game. I think there are many and plenty of them. But guys, how much time do you spend playing games? Do you know, per day or per week, let's say, how many hours do you spend on the game?
Depends on the week, but likely at least 20.
20 hours?
At least, yeah, a week.
Per week, all right. Yeah. I thought per day.
I would be jealous then. When I was a student?
Yeah. You played 20 in a row?
Not in a row, but...
All right. You guys?
I'm playing Mass Effect now, the re-release, so now quite a lot, maybe too much, but yeah, I don't know, it's really fun to go back to an old game, so it's, I don't know, at least 3 hours every day, because I don't go anywhere.
Perfect time.
Yep.
I play some hours a week, I don't play every day, but I play some hours a week, yeah.
All right, what, and you?
Just 1-2 hours maximally.
Per day?
Yeah.
Or per week?
Per day.
Per day. Thanks God. All right, guys. Thank you very much. Thank you for your interesting talk and your answers. That was amazing.
Thank you for filling.
Thank you. Okay.